safe. So with these words, अच्छा सब लोग प्लीज माइक अपना अपना म्यूट कर लीजिए रिस्पॉन्स आ रहा है इसलिए मैं कह रहा हूँ I'm about to mute my own mic in a moment. अच्छा सलाम साहब आज आपके चेयरमैन कौन है अध्यक्ष कौन है इस सेशन के
मुझे कोई इन्फॉर्म नहीं किया कि कोई ऑफिशियल चेयरमैन है तो आप ही हैं सर.
नहीं, ऐसी बात नहीं. मैंने पिछली बार सुझाव किया था कि जैसे हम नॉर्मली किया करते थे तो मैं कहूँगा कि फेलोज खुद मतलब सजेस्ट कर सकते हैं अपनी इच्छा, मतलब आप यारों को आपकी इच्छा बता सकते हैं कि हम चाहते हैं कि तो आज कोई हम ऐसा करें, हम एक वॉलंटियर मांग लेते हैं. काफी सीनियर लोग भी मौजूद है और खास करके अगर किसी को अरबिक लिटरेचर में रुचि है, जानकारी है और हम लोगों को टॉपिक बहुत दिलचस्प लग रहा है क्योंकि कंटेम्प्रेरी अरबिक लिटरेचर में भारत की छवि क्या है, तो सलाम साहब इस पे शोध कार्य अपना करने जा रहे हैं. एंड आई थिंक दिस शुड बी अ वेरी यूनिक काइंड ऑफ वर्क व्हेन इट इज प्रोड्यूस्ड बिकॉज वी ओनली नो अ फ्यू अरबिक राइटर्स, यू नो, लाइक महफूज एंड वेरी फ्यू ऑफ देम आई थिंक. और one of my actual personal friends, you know, the great Palestinian poet,
Mohammad Darwish.
Exactly, Mohammad Darwish, Darwish, who passed away. I've met him several times.
Then Adonis is
there. Sorry?
Adonis
also I've met personally. Another very great poet. So I'm saying, but most of us know only a few, you know, of the Arabic writers. In fact, Banipal, there's a magazine called Banipal which comes out of London, and the editor is a friend of mine, and he left Syria and he's done a lot of translation into English. I also know some other famous Egyptian writers. There's a lady, a very senior lady who was also Najaf.
Nawaz Sadawi.
Yeah, Sadawi, exactly. Yeah. So we know a few of them, but we don't know a lot of them, and we haven't actually, you know, seen their work from this angle, okay, you know, the lens, the perspective that they may have on India. So we are very much looking forward to your work, Salam Saab. And I request one of, I think maybe Alka Ji can chair the meeting. She's also from literature. I can see her face here. Alka Ji, namaste. Will you chair the meeting? आप अपना माइक अनम्यूट कर दीजिए एंड देन यू कैन से यस एंड देन आई विल म्यूट माय माइक.
मकरन जी, मुझे अरबिक लिटरेचर की बिल्कुल भी समझ नहीं है. आई एम रियली लुकिंग फॉरवर्ड टू दिस.
आई एग्री. मैं दैट्स व्हाट आई सेड, नन ऑफ अस इज अ मास्टर लेट अलोन अ स्टूडेंट ऑफ अरबिक लिटरेचर. But I mean, you're familiar with the idea of representation, because all of post-colonialism mein sara discourse usi pe bana hai ke how the West is representing the rest. And you know, after all, Edward Said comes from that area. He was born in Egypt. He's a Palestinian, of course. But I mean, the whole basis of this is how, you know, one cultural, you might say, universe represents another cultural universe, and what are the dynamics of it? What is the politics of it? And of course, when we think about Arabic literature, like Western literature, then at least for the last 100 years or so, it is also part of the so-called third world. It's not, you know, if you went back 1,000 years ago,
a part of non-aligned movement as well. So yeah,
exactly. I mean, what I'm saying is, if you went back 1,000 years, you might say, chalo, they were a dominant force, they were conquering the world, they wrote about the rest of the world. Last 100 years, we are practically in the same boat, or certainly, exactly. You know, after the First World War, and you know, the defeat of the Ottomans and the creation of all the modern Arab states goes back to that. Anyhow, so that's why I mentioned you. But no pressure. Koi aur bhi kar sakta hai. Hara sahab, agar you like, would you like to chair, Hara sahab? Or I see Satendra ji also. Wo bhi baithe hain. So any one of you, please just indicate, just raise your hands, and then I will put my mic on mute and I will hand it back to the chair and also to, of course, Dr. Salam. Please.
Sir, quickly, on.
Satendra ji, Dr. Satendra Kumar. Yes, yes.
It was just a minute, sir.
Mic is muted.
Sir, my request is that Hada Sahab will be better because he is familiar with literature.
Okay, Hada Sahab, please raise your hand if you agree. Agar aapko aap manzoor hain, agar aap razi hain, to thank you. Hum maan lete hain ki aap razi hain. Sorry, sunai nahi de raha, isliye main keh raha hu. Aap mic unmute kijiye aur main ab mic apna mute karne ja raha hu. Hada Sahab, please conduct the proceedings and. All the best, Salam Sahab. We are looking forward to your presentation. Thank you so much.
Thank you, sir. Thank you.
Adil bhai, सबसे पहले अपने चेहरे पर थोड़ी लाइट करिए क्योंकि वो मुझे लगता है कि अंधेरे में है. हाँ, अब ठीक है. हाँ, तो मैं आदिल भाई से निवेदन करता हूँ कि वो अपने सीधे अपने विषय पर आए और ये विषय जो हम सब लोगों के लिए थोड़ा नया आया और हम सब इससे अपरिचित हैं, उस पर अपनी शोध परियोजना हमें स्पष्ट करें.
थैंक यू सर. सो सिंस दिस इज माय फर्स्ट प्रेजेंटेशन व्हिच इज इंट्रोडक्टरी प्रेजेंटेशन, सो आई हैव वेरी लेस टाइम बिकॉज आई एम बीन टोल्ड दैट इट्स लाइक 20-30 मिनट्स बिकॉज वी हैव द सेशन ऑफ 40 मिनट्स ओनली. सो आई विल रीड आउट. आई होप एवरीबॉडी इज लिसनिंग, राइट?
यस.
So I'll read out and then I'll briefly discuss, I mean, in between. So I'll start with my introduction. So yeah, so I'll start with my introduction. Everybody is ready? Yeah, okay. So India has been the subject of study for Arabs since the advent of Islam or before the advent of Islam through the contacts of Arab with Indians date back to pre-Islamic era. Arabs voyaged to India for commercial purposes, which was a hub of trade as well as the gateway to access to a vast market of China, made India the subject of study to maintain healthy relations with Indian kings as well as it would help Arabs to assimilate in Indian land.
लैपटॉप का ये फेस है, थोड़ा सामने करिए, आपका चेहरा नहीं दिख रहा है.
So Al Jahiz was one of the first Arab writer to use word Al Hind, which is translated as India, while praising India as the land of wisdom. So, voice is echoing. So Professor MP Singh, could you switch off your mic and the professor Dr. Namyar?
माइक को बंद करना.
माइक को बंद कर रहे हैं. कैसे बंद करें? नहीं जानते.
नहीं वो
तो रिकॉर्डिंग चल रही है.
So Al Jahiz was one of the first Arab writer to use Al Hind while praising India as a land of wisdom and of having a huge sum of wealth. Many Arab writers, especially travelers, geographers, and historians have made India the subject of their study, and many of them have been to India between 9th to 16th century. And some of the prominent figures to visit India are Sulaiman al-Tajir, al-Masudi, al-Abu Rehan al-Biruni, Ibn Battuta, Ibn Hawqal, Abu Zayd Sarafi, and others. Arab beliefs of Adam arrival in Ceylon, which is translated as Sarandip in Arabic, and in modern day Sri Lanka. And Arab considered Sri Lanka as a part of India. So thus, this is the point. So that their belief of Adam's arrival in Ceylon gives great importance to India. India-Arab relations were not confined to trade, is extended to educational cultural relations as well. First encounter of Indian culture and tradition was through direct interaction during their stay in India for commercial purposes long back. However, it did not stop there. With the advent of Islam in Arabian Peninsula, a paradigm shift was witnessed in the dynamic of relationship between the two nations. It encompassed educational and cultural relations as well. Arab scholars greatly benefited from Greek philosophy. They did not lag in gaining the knowledge of Indian philosophy as well as other disciplines such as mathematics, medicine, astronomy, to name a few. Canonical Arabic history have extensively talked about the arrival of Indian scholar to Arab countries, particularly in the Abbasi era. And we have Darul Hikmah, which was founded by the Mamun during the era of Harun Rashid. And that was patronized by a family called Brahmika. And there is a lot of talk about Brahmika and their origins. So some of the Indian writers like Sayyid Salman Nadvi, who was the prominent writer in Indo-Arab relations, he traced the origin of Brahmika in India and somewhere in Kashmir, and their religion to be Buddhism. India has always been an Arab narrations, as numerous stories mentioned places and characters from India, such as Sindbad Behri, Ali Baba, and many others. And one of the canonical texts that has been translated from Arabic into Pahlavi and then, from Sanskrit into Pahlavi and then Arabic, called Kalila Dimna, which is very popular book in Arabic literature. So besides many references occurred in the story books, folk tales, some hadiths, prophetic traditions, and tafsir, India has been found in all those things, and there are so many hadiths which refers to India. Swati hadith, which is the prophetic traditions. And particularly, I would like to mention Ad-Durrul Mansur, which is written by Suyuti, and I think back in 15th, 16th century. And before that, we have Tabri. Tabri has mentioned India. And there is a lot of talk about Adam's arrival in India. And we have so many stories. I don't know the authenticity of that stories. And there are a lot of talk about that. But the fact is that it mentioned in this book of Tafsir, which is the explanation of Quran. And one of the things that Adam came to India firstly, and then after, we have so many verses like Allah taught Adam some words. So these words are taught in India. So that's how, I mean, Siraram do so many references in early Islamic a commentary of Quran. During the Umayyad and Abbasi period, which is between 661 into 1258, tremendous progress was made, and Damascus and Baghdad simultaneously, Abbasi and Umayyad period, emerged as a hub of knowledge and science, which attracted scholars from around the globe, including India. The Indian scholars were of prime importance. They had made their Arab counterparts look into Indian people and culture through organized scholarly representation. In the given period, we find many Arab historians who talked about India, such as Masudi, Ali Idrisi, and At-Tabari. One of the things that I would like to mention that there were so many people who were historians as well as geographers, like Masudi. However, from the 19th century onwards, with the Renaissance in modern Arabic world and due to emergence of various school of thought in Islamic world, such as Wahhabi, Pan-Islamic movement, as well as the expansion of literature and literary studies, their understanding of India is no longer consistent, but has expanded significantly. Similarly, India image in Europe world has changed. The frequent Arab traveling to India also impacted upon dynamic of India in Arab side. The 20th century has seen the rise of Arab scholars who have taken a keen interest in Indian religion and culture and personalities such as Mahatma Gandhi, Jawaharlal Nehru, Rabindranath Tagore, and others. Many Arab travelers like Nasir Abudi, Sayyid Turahi, Nawal Sa'dawi, Amina Saeed have discussed India in great detail. Nasir Abudi needs a special mention as he has made more than a dozen visits to India, more than a dozen, ranging from Kashmir to Kerala, and has written more than 15 books based on his visit on India. Umar Abu Risha, Ahmad Shawki, Khalil Mutran, Rashid Salim Khoury, and many other poets have penned down on Indian themes such as Buddha, Gandhi, Nehru, Tagore, Taj Mahal, Khajuraho, and other themes. One of the features of modern Arab writers is that they have also focused on the translation of Indian religion texts such as Ramayana, Mahabharata, Manusmriti, and some part of Vedas with introduction and brief commentary. Apart from these translations, they have discussed Indian religion, Hinduism, Buddhism, Jainism, and Sikhism in great detail. Many of them have made a comparison between Islam and Indian religions and talked about the impact of Indian religion on Sufism and took up many issues pertaining to Islam and Indian religion. This Project Indian in Contemporary Arabic Literature offers a critical analysis of Arabic literary texts on Indian theme from 1945 till the end of 20th century. Since there are many genres of Arabic literature and most of them, India has formed a mention, it will be tough task to evaluate all forms of literatures. Thus, I intended to focus only on travel literature, poetry, and religion. Objective of the study. Despite being very close geographically and having relations with Arabs since ancient time, some scholars refer India relation with Arabs and back to Mohenjo-daro and Harappa. They have discussed about the Egyptian relations with them, and historians know very well. So the mutual relations could not extend further, especially after the fall of Abbasid era. The knowledge gap is seen afterward. Though there has been some contribution before Arab Renaissance in the late 18th century, the struggle for independence and with the formation of modern state in Arab world, Arabs have renewed relation with India in many aspects, and this provided a new space for dialogue and quest for understanding each other. It has helped create a great body of knowledge by which we can understand each other. My main objective to see India from Arab writers' point of view who have written in Arabic literature, on Arabic language only, and made comparison with the work produced by early Arab writers such as Jahiz, Sulaiman al-Tajir, Masudi ibn Battuta, al-Biruni, and others. Furthermore, I would strive to find out what they have added in terms of knowledge production with regards to Indian culture, religion, and modern way of Indian life. It would be interesting to see the kind of addition that they have made, especially by some of them who have been to this part of India, such as UP, Bihar, Orissa, Assam, and other part of India, which was not explored by Arab writers before. In addition to that, my aim would be to look into the debate of colonization of India by Arab through the textual analysis of literary works and find out whether they have the sense of lost land that they have governed a long period of time. The scope of the study. The current project would confine to the analysis of the literary works of Arabic literature and religion. Since there are many genres of Arabic literature, I have taken travel literature, poetry, and religion only, as it would be more helpful in studying the subject more critically and closely. Thus, other body of literature such as novels, short stories, fiction is out of the purview of my study. Likewise, I did not follow the commercial as well as the diplomatic relation between India and Arab nation and the current development emanating as a result of political realignment in India and Arab nations. The project will help understand the nature of Arab scholarship with regards to India and what kind of messages Arab writers are sending out to their readers. It is very crucial since Arab writers, those who are writing in Arabic, has a huge influence on masses, and they create public perception in both affirmative and negative. My research question, I have briefly four research questions. So I would like to, first of all, the question is, how do the modern Arab writer look at India, and how they do differ from their medieval and early Islamic counterparts? This question will address the chronological development of Arab understanding of India and try to dig out the differences of opinion over the period of time due to changes in nature of their relationship between two geographical entities. And the second question is, have Pan-Islamism and Pan-Arabism or Arab nationalism led to any change in their perception about India? There are divergent discourse about Pan-Islamic movement across the world, particularly post 9/11 US. Thus, Islam is being seen differently. So is their relationship with other nations and people of other faiths. This question will critically engage with Arab writer associated with Pan-Islamic movement and will examine whether this has something to do with their thinking of India. The third question is there any colonial attitude of Arabs towards Indian people and culture at par with English colonial, or they have very much Asian in dealing with Indian issues? The last decade has witnessed a lot of talks about Islamic colonization of India or Arab colonization of India in academia. In order to address this issue, I will try to engage with literary texts employing post-colonial theory. And the third question is, has India been seen as a single unified cultural nation? There are a lot of talk about, I mean, the India, the construction of post-colonial era and all. So, I mean, I will try to look into this from other points of view. The idea with this question is that if there is a generalization of India's culture and tradition in Arabs writing, or they are aware of diversity in India in all spheres of life, the hypothesis, based on my preliminary research, I have hypothesized that Arab writers have presented India as a nation that has democratic values and regarded that India as a champion of human rights, as in the case of Palestine, and we can see, and Arabs have found a lot of support of Palestinian cause. So yeah, they have that sort of impression. And despite the emergence of pan-Islamic and Wahhabi movement in Arab nations, it has minimal effect on their understanding of India. Arabs have moved on from the caliphate era due to modern state formation that has occupied their mind. At the extent in which they are it is nearly impossible for them to think India as their lost land, which should be reclaimed for their past glory. India is being seen as a friendly country which has a lot to offer in the field of science and technology, philosophy and other disciplines. However, there are some apprehension about the treatment of Muslim community by Indian administration, as well as the issue of Kashmir is reflected in their writing in early 90s and afterwards. As far as methodology of the research is concerned, the source of study is, I'll imply the textual analytical approach to the study of India in travel literature, poetry, and the text that deal with the subject of religion. This is besides using comparative method to examine the pre-20th century and the contemporary writing in order to understand the differences as well as the changes that occurred over the period of time. Besides studying earlier Arabic writings on India and making a lot of reference to their work, the material I have relied upon are the travelogue of contemporary writers like Nasir Abudi, Nawal Sadawi, Saeed Turahi, as well as the poetry written by Umar Aburisha, Ahmad Shauqi, Jamil Sidqi Zahavi, and others. As far as the book on the Indian religion are concerned, I will refer to the books written by Ahmad Shibli, translated, and the translation of Mahabharat by Abdul Ilah al-Mallah, and writing of Saeed Turahi, Ahmad Ali Ajiba, and others. This project is divided into four chapters followed by conclusion. So first chapters will give a brief account of Arabs' contact with India and the nature of their relations in pre-Islamic world. This also includes an overview of early Arab geographers, historians on India, along with their perception of India geographically and culturally during the Islamic era. In addition to that, I will try to trace Indian pre-modern Arabic literature writing. The second chapter will discuss contemporary Arabic travel writing by Arabs, and will try to understand the difference between early Arab travelers with modern travelers, along with the differences in purposes of travel. My special focus will be on the writings of famous Saudi writers, Nasir Abudi, Egyptian writers like Anis Mansur, Nawal Sadawi, and Amina Sayyid. The third chapter deals with the Arabic poetry on India. Modern Arabic writers have devoted many writings on Indian themes, such as Khajuraho, Taj Mahal, Kashmir, and others. Indian personalities have also found prominent place in their writings. I will try to dig a bit deeper to understand the nature of their devotion to India. The first chapter will be on Indian religion. The fourth chapter will be on the Indian religion that have been the subject of study during last century, especially in the light of comparative religion. This will also talk about the translation of Indian religious texts such as Ramayana, Mahabharata, and others. It will also address the problem of superiority of Arabs' religion on Indian religions, if that exists in their writing. So that is the brief introduction of my topic. So I think I have to conclude on this note. So I'm open to, I would like to have so many suggestions and the comments on this topic. So please, Dr. Patel, Professor Patel.
धन्यवाद आदिल भाई और मुझे
सॉरी हरा साहब, आप अपना रिमार्क देने के बाद मुझे अबाउट 30 सेकंड्स दे सकते हैं, तो फिर प्लीज मैं अपना हाथ ऊपर रखना
जी 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 मैं आदिल भाई को धन्यवाद दूंगा, उन्होंने बहुत विस्तार से अरबी साहित्य की मध्यकाल से लगाकर अभी तक की यात्रा हमारे सामने प्रस्तुत की, और जो समकालीन अरबी लेखन है उस पर भी विस्तार से प्रकाश डाला, और अपनी परियोजना प्रस्तुत की। मुझे जहाँ तक स्मरण है, आरंभ में भारत में जितने अरबी लेखक थे सल्तनत काल में और मुगल काल में, वो सब अरब देशों से ही आए थे। मुझे अपने काम के सिलसिले में एक राइटर ध्यान है, हाजी उद्दबीर, अरबिक हिस्ट्री ऑफ गुजरात, और मुझे लगता है कि वो अपने गुजरात वाले दरबार में बड़े सम्मानित व्यक्तियों में से थे। अरबी साहित्य और भारतीय साहित्य में एक बुनियादी समानता इन दिनों बहुत लक्ष्य की जा रही है, वो ये है कि दोनों ही प्रकार के साहित्य औपनिवेशिक चेतना से मुक्त होने की जद्दोजहद में, ये एक बड़ी समानता है। लेकिन जैसे मेरे लिए अभी भी एक बड़ी जिज्ञासा मेरे मन में है, वो ये है कि जैसे उर्दू भारतीय भाषा हो गई, जैसे अंग्रेजी भारतीय भाषा हो गई, अरबी को अभी भी भारतीय भाषा का दर्जा प्राप्त नहीं है। और मैं अब हमारे माननीय निदेशक जी से अनुरोध करूंगा कि वो अपनी बात कहें।
ओह थैंक यू, थैंक यू। सलाम साहब, यू नो यूजुअली व्हेन आई लिसन टू यू नो प्रेजेंटेशन लाइक योर्स, वन ऑफ द फर्स्ट क्वेश्चंस आई हैव इन माय ओन माइंड इज, you know, what kind of book is going to come out of this, you know, what kind of final research product. And, you know, for that, I feel that the delimiting of the scope of research is crucial, because if your questions are too ambitious or too, you know, what we may call spread out, phele hue sawal ho, to phir usko, you know, kisi natije pe lana, kisi, you know, final destination pe lana kabhi kabhi kathin ho sakta hai. So I mean, your research questions are wonderful, but I can see, let me start on a positive note. I can see how you are restricting yourself to travel writing. I think now this is a very important thing. Now once you do that, then perhaps in your introduction or in your first part itself, you can make that clear. And if there are other, you know, fiction writers, poets who have written a lot about India, you can mention them in the passing and, you know, sort of eliminate them. That is one thing. Now, see, travel writing is a very special kind of genre, and usually only rich people travel, because for them, I mean, sorry to put it so crudely, but in the context of the post-colonial, critique of Western imperialism, it has been found that it is the rich countries which travel to these exotic, far-off countries. And there's a wonderful book called Marketing the Exotic, you know, by Graham Huggan. It's a good book to look at in terms of framing this whole issue. Now, there's another wonderful book by Sugata Bose, where there is a different notion of travel across the Indian Ocean, the commerce and the crossing, you know, between the Arab Peninsula and India, you know, the Arabian Sea as a passage, as a seaboard, where bidirectional traffic among travelers, pilgrims, because a lot of Indians went for the Hajj, you know, and bidirectional. So my real point is that once you have delimited your scope to travel writing, after that, you also need to have some, I think, very well worked out theoretical, you might say, fundamentals or principles. The third thing is, you know, when you're comparing the medieval approach or the, historical approach of the conquerors to modern writers, you know, I mean, for me, this is really opening up huge swathes, you know, huge archives of material, where the comparison can get very, very complicated without some cautionary narrowing down. And then you've brought in, you know, the rise of Wahhabism, neo-Wahhabism, maybe 9/11 figures somewhere. You know, all this may get very, very complicated. My whole point is that I think it is really important, very, very important to limit. And because only when you limit though I must say the themes are wonderful, including the nostalgia for the lost land. But how that plays out in terms of, you know, many Arab countries themselves undergoing a form of colonialism, you know, by the Turks and then, you know, by British proxy, etc. So I'm only saying, to conclude, I'm saying the thing that concerns me in a project like this is how to delimit and narrow the scope, number one. Number two, whether it's generic, thematic, chronological, etc. Number two, you know, how to create a very strong methodological foundation so that, you know, something will come out, I mean, theoretical, methodological, so that, you know, the outcome, the output will be valuable and which you can relate, you know, because the last point I wanted to make is even when we think about a very, you've brought in some of this, but if you think about a very important figure like Maulana Azad, you know, who actually founded the Indian Council of Cultural Relations, was, I believe, an education minister. Well, you know, his early upbringing and education was in Cairo. And, you know, the point being that that there was, and Maulana Maududi and all that. So there's a very deep kind of connection, I feel, you know, between the Arab world and the Indian world. Prior to, you know, let's say just 100 years ago, prior to the current period where you have a different kind of connection because of the Gulf labor, you know, and there's a wonderful Malayali novel called Goat Days, you know, I don't know if you read this novel, but it's really worth reading. And it's about Indian laborers in the Gulf, you know, and their treatment, you know, by their, you know, owners. And it was a huge bestseller. I'm told I read it in English because it's translated into English by Penguin Books. So I'm saying that there are these inflection points which complicate this relationship, you know, of travelers to India. That's my only point. And somehow you've got to kind of arrange all this in such a way that, you know, there's an output that is manageable. Thank you so much. Thank you,
sir. Thank you. So I would like to mention, I mean, two things. I mean, first of all, that whatever the moment happened, like Wahhabism or Pan-Islamism, certainly that has connection with India and even the Iranian Revolution. So the father of this pan-Islamism movement is Jamaluddin Afghani. And Jamaluddin Afghani has a deep connection with India. He has been to India. And I mean, spent, I think, two to three years in India. So that one thing. And the Khomeini has also roots in India. So that is one thing. And the other thing is that some of these writers have had this. I think the video is stuck. So, sir, can you hear me?
I can hear you very well. Thank you. Go ahead. You're making very important points. Go ahead.
So they have had that sort of relationship with these moments. Like I mentioned Nasir Abudi. So Nasir Abudi has made India for very sort of religious person. So, I mean, that the effect of this, the religiosity and this pan-Islamism is reflected in that writing. So I'm not looking directly into this pan-Islamism and Wahhabism. I'm trying to figure out these things through their writings. And as you mentioned that the scope of my research or concentration of my research will be on this travel literature. So that's how I'm trying to make it. I mean, this is still early phase. I will talk to you and other fellows in this regard. So yeah, that's 2 points I had to make.
Thank you so much. Carry on, please.
Yeah, thank you, sir. Professor Patel.
Adil, ये बहुत ही अच्छा presentation लगा मुझे और बहुत ही इसमें scope है बात करने का और हम लोगों को बताने का. आप हमें बताएंगे कि अरब के हमारे ताल्लुकात हैं या व्हाट काइंड ऑफ रिलेशनशिप वी हैड. यू मेंशन ब्रीफली अबाउट द मिडिवल टाइम एंड पीरियड बिफोर 1945. आई हैव फ्यू सजेशंस टू ऑफर. One which has already been pointed out by Professor Paranjpe is that you need to limit this. I mean, you have he has spoken on it in a very interesting manner, and that gives you something to think about. I have an impression that your work is trying to come towards one kind of interpretation. This may be wrong. But it's an impression that you are trying to avoid some of the key issues which might interest the readers. Okay? And talking about the general connections, historical connections between India and Arab world is one thing. And your dealing with the post 1945 understanding of India is something really very different. Because you're also bringing in one important question, that was India seen as a civilization, as one civilization? And in that connection, there are some very important questions which will come up. And I see that you are taking travel literature and you're not taking history or any kind of direct understanding of how Arab world looked at Indian subcontinent, if I may put it that way. Okay, so if you bring in those questions, some politics and political understanding also comes. I'm raising this point because you have mentioned in your presentation that India was seen as a democratic country, and you have also bring in Philistine and human rights and all that. In that connection, a reader might be interested in knowing about Arabs' response to the making of Pakistan, coming of Pakistan, because you're starting from 45. So we would be interested in knowing how Arab world could see this. Was it seen by from an Islamic perspective, or was it seen differently? This may interest us. And second and more important, this would be slightly technical, you have to say that you are dealing with Arab world. Arab world is a different world, and Arab, because this is to be clearly stated that you are dealing with Arab world and some specific texts. Okay, that will make things easier for you, because as already has been pointed out, there is a scope of getting spread out. There is a scope. I mean, there is a possibility that it can spread out. And also there is a possibility that the researcher may take a convenient position of looking at history in a way, looking India from Arabic point of view, in such a way that some good things are said and some crucial questions are not addressed. So in that case, a clarity would make things easier for you, because a lot of things depend on it. You cannot go into a wide range of sources and then come up with something which may not be giving us a real picture of how Arab felt about Indians. And I see it is a wonderful project. And if you limit your work, then I think it would be very, very interesting work.
Thank you, sir. First of all, I mean, you have talked about, I mean, giving this whole project in a way. And my reply would be like, I have included many other writers, like those writers who are not, I mean, what I say, like ideologically aligned to some one party, like Nasir Abodi is aligned to one party. And we have Nawal Sadawi, which is hardcore feminist. And we have this Amina Saeed that has some Marxist interpretation. So that's also one of the points. And with regards to the politicization of issue, India as being seen as a democratic country, and I will suggest to you one paper that I have, image of India in Arab world, shapes and shades. And I have printed with me and you can take it. And that's there in, so the point is in that India have had some sort of tricky relations with Arabs. And India, some of the argument that has been made that India have supported Palestine because they want some purchase from Arab world with regards to Pakistan. So they cannot interfere with Indian project of Pakistan and Kashmir. So that's how Kashmir was also not on the table of this OIC, Organization of Islamic Conference, as well as the Pakistan. So there have been the clashes with the Arab worlds, within Arab worlds, about this Pakistan issue, and Pakistan had tried hardly about, I mean, cornering India with regards to this Kashmir issue and others. So that has been there, but that was the, I mean, the consistent position of Arab till this that Babri Masjid incident happened. That all is mentioned there, and there are two others. Incident that have influenced their perception about India. That's why I have mentioned about the post Babri Masjid issue, and also their perception has, I mean, not that was before. So that is out of scope of my research, but still, I mean, I look at from this point of view, and I have, and the most of the things that have been covered, I mean, this story of Kashmir and all that. All these issues are covered in the media only, and this is one of the prominent newspaper is Ahram, which is weekly, and Ashraqul Awsat, which is published in English as well as in Arabic. So, and thank you for your suggestions. I hope I have covered some of the, I mean, the issue that you have raised, and yeah, you are very right in narrowing down the topic. I'm still in the process of, I mean, choosing some and not choosing some. So this. Thank you very much. Professor Subramaniam, so there are a lot of questions, so I will read out one to one and then I'll come to it. First, will you be discussing India of post 1947 or South Asia in general? Yeah, I will be discussing India only, not South Asia, because the India of in the India of medieval in the eye of Arab is different from in India that is today. So yeah, certainly in this project, my focus will be on the modern India, not the South Asia in general. And the second question is, what is the Arabic literature here, writers from Saudi or the peninsula or the entire region of Arab writers from Iraq? No, I have not covered all the area. I know that Arabs start from Iraq till this Morocco, and there are so many nations. But my scholarship focus will be on the Saudi Arabia and Egypt for the two reasons. Because in modern world, Egypt is being regarded as the leader of this educational hub. Like Azhar is considered to be the prime institute in Arab world, so for that, and the religious authority is the Saudi Arabia. So of course that will not serve the purpose, but at some extent for the sake of narrowing down the topic, I'll be focusing on these two regions only. And third question is, will it include Arab writers on the Islam, Indian Islam, especially in the light of Wahhabi? So first I will come, okay. Will it include Arabic writer on the Indian Islam? Yeah, that will be the part of the project while discussing Islam. And Indian Islam, some sort of, I mean, making of this Indian writers. I mean, when it comes to, I mean, seeing Islam from Arab point of view, there is no such thing like Indian Islam and the European Islam. I mean, European Islam has been discussed in the Europe, like Tariq Ramadan has discussed about the European Islam. But with Arabs, I don't see any, I mean, this sort of terminology. So, and the issue of comparison, why focus on the millennial earlier? Why not make contemporary Persia or European Orientalism? I'm comparing literature with the literature and the within country, so I don't know how to compare Europeans with Arabic and the Persian with Arabic. So my comparison will be within the subject. And the last question is, how can you keep contemporary Arabic commercial and political development out of your analysis that may provide a crucial explanatory framework? That's true. I mean, that will provide, but I have to narrow down my topic. And if I'll stick to some area that has been suggested by Professor Patel, our director, and then Professor Patel. So, I mean, if I can find out a way by which we can, I mean, accumulate all those things in my limited area. So I'll take suggestion from you in this regard. And Sunita Mitra, I want to know about the writer, where they have chiefly from literature or other discipline. Sorry, Sunitra, your question is not very clear. So could you elaborate it, please?
Am I audible now?
Yeah.
I just want to know, you are dealing with travel literature, and who are the writers? Are they professional writers, or they are drawn from several disciplines like history or diplomacy or something like that?
Yeah,
because
there are
all of the different disciplines will different kind of impression on the writing.
True. So one is religious writer like Nasir Abodi. Then we have one diplomat writer, Ihab, I forgot the full name. And the third one is Nawal Sadawi, which is feminist Egyptian lady writer. So these are three different genres. And Nawal Sadawi is also a novel writer. So somehow, I mean, they are related to literature or this religion. So yeah.
Literature or religion. But about the feminist writer whom you mentioned, I didn't hear.
Feminist, she's also a novel writer. So somehow literature.
So do they write in Arabic? Their works getting translated into English?
No. The things that I have taken is in Arabic exclusively. And even the priest, even the sources that I will be taking is in Arabic only.
Okay. So the writers, if we do not have access to the writers, we won't be having access to the writers if we do not know Arabic. Then. If we want to read, is there some translation work going on?
Some of have been translated, like the travelogue of Nawal Sadawi is translated. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Some of the texts have been translated, but not all.
Okay, thank you.
Professor Hazarika, do you find about caste system among Indian Muslim in writings of Arabs? No, that is not addressed. They have addressed the caste system of among Hindus in Arabic writing, in medieval Arabic writing, that Al-Biruni's caste writing is very famous, and then others. But Indian caste system is very different. Muslims caste system is very different from, I mean, Hindu caste system. So, I mean, they have talked about it, but not in that way.
आदिल भाई, जो आप जिन यात्राओं की बात कर रहे हैं, वो भारतीय लेखकों की अरब देशों की यात्राएं हैं।
भारतीय देशों की? जी,
भारतीय लेखकों की।
हाँ,
जो अरबी राइटर्स हैं आपके, वो सारे भारतीय हैं या नहीं?
नहीं, सारे अरब्स हैं, भारतीयों की हमने बात ही नहीं की इसमें। मेरे पास काफी सारे वर्क हैं जो इंडियन राइटर्स ने इंडिया पे काम किया अरबिक में, जिसमें दो नाम बहुत मशहूर है, तोहफतुल मुजाहिदीन और एक सुबहतुल मरजान फी आसार हिंदुस्तान। इसमें बहुत ज्यादा बात की गई है इंडिया को लेकर, जो रिलीजियस टेक्स्ट है उसमें, जैसे प्रोफेटिक ट्रेडिशन में कि प्रॉफिट ने क्या कहा। जैसे इकबाल का एक बहुत मशहूर शेर है कि क्या कहते हैं, मीरे अरब को आई ठंडी हवा जहां से, मेरा वतन वही है, मेरा वतन वही है। तो मीरे अरब यहाँ रेफर किया उन्होंने मोहम्मद, प्रॉफिट मोहम्मद को, कि प्रॉफिट मोहम्मद ने एक बार इंक्वायर किया कि ये ठंडी हवा कहाँ से आ रही, तो किसी ने कहा कि ये हिंदुस्तान से आ रही। तो ये सब चीजें हैं डिस्कस की हुई, लेकिन उसको मैं मेरे मेरे इसमें नहीं है।
कोई भारतीय लेखक भी है जो अरबी में लिख रहे हैं?
जी जी, यही तो मैंने दो नाम दिए, इसके अलावा बहुत सारे नाम हैं। इन दोनों ने एक्सक्लूसिवली इंडिया पे लिखा, तोहफतुल मुजाहिदीन जिन्होंने अरबी में लिखा इंडियन, जैसे तोहफतुल मुजाहिदीन एक्सक्लूसिवली जो जो मलयाली स्ट्रगल है अगेंस्ट पोर्टुगीज उस पर बेस्ड है, और तो सुबहतुल मरजान फियासार हिंदुस्तान जो है वो इंडियन राइटिंग्स को लेकर है, इंडिया इंडिया के बारे में जो क्या कहते हैं इसकी जो इम्पोर्टेंस है रिलीजियस टेक्स्ट में उसको लेकर, और प्लस इंडिया का जो लिटरेरी सिग्निफिकेंस है उसको लेकर भी उन्होंने डिस्कस किया है, स्पेशली प्रोसोडी के इस कॉन्टेक्स्ट में जो हम लिटरेचर वालों को काफी ज्यादा इंटरेस्ट पैदा करता है उसको। मेरे पास सी के राजू साहब का सवाल है, वो काफी ज्यादा है, तो आई थिंक मैं उनको एड्रेस कर दूंगा मेल पे ही।
मुझे लगता है उस पर आप एक लिखित प्रतिक्रिया करके और डाल दें तो ज्यादा ठीक रहेगा।
जी जी, क्योंकि उनके काफी सारे लंबे क्वेश्चन
और बहुत विस्तृत प्रतिक्रिया अपेक्षित है।
जी जी जी, मैं उनको लिया हूं, मेरे पास था यहाँ पे प्रिंट आउट, लेकिन
नहीं, आप ग्रुप में शेयर कर दें ताकि सभी लोग उसको देख पाए।
लोग भी जानना चाहते हैं कि उन सवालों का क्या जवाब आपने दिया है।
नहीं नहीं, जरूर जरूर, सारे सबको रिप्लाई टू ऑल रहेगा, तो सारे जवाब
देंगे। बहुत बढ़िया,
थैंक यू,
बहुत बढ़िया,
थैंक यू सर,
थैंक यू। और कोई जिज्ञासा हो तो ठीक, नहीं तो हम आदिल डॉक्टर आदिल सलाम को धन्यवाद देते हैं, और उनके और मुझे विश्वास है कि आप सब ने जो संशोधन और संवर्धन सुझाए हैं वे सब अपने इस रूपरेखा में शामिल करेंगे। मैं उनके प्रति हृदय से कृतज्ञ हूँ और आप सब दर्शकों श्रोताओं का भी हृदय से कृतज्ञ हूँ। धन्यवाद,
थैंक यू सर। Okay.